Animation controllers are state machines, which, as the name suggests, are a set of states. Each controller can only be in one state at a time, however, multiple controllers can be running at the same time. Each state in the machine specifies two main things: the actions done in a state, and the condition to move into another state. This can be easily represented with a flowchart. The diagram in front of you is an example of a possible world border flowchart. The animation controller first initiates a variable for reference. I'll cover variables among other things in a different video. The animation controller starts in the default state. The default state tells the controller to do nothing, but branches off into four directions, all very similar to one another. The default state tests if the player's X position is exceeding the border radius. If that is true, the state machine moves into the positive X state, where it then teleports the player inside of the border, producing the border effect. The positive X state tests when the player's X position no longer exceeds the border radius, which then transitions back into the default state. This process is repeated similarly for the negative X, positive Z, and negative Z states. As shown in the World Border Animation Controller, a teleport command is run whenever the player first enters a state. A state specifies actions to do while in the state. In the case of Rhesus Pack Animation Controllers, this tells the entity to play a certain animation or something else visual. This is where the term animation controller and similarly animation comes from. In the case of Behavior Pack Animation Controllers, the state can run entity events, commands, or declare and modify variables. This video covers Behavior Pack Animation Controllers, so I won't be explaining the Rhesus Pack. A Behavior Pack Animation Controller can do their actions by means of when the state is entered into, when the state has been left, or utilizing Behavior Pack Animations while the state is running. Again, I won't be explaining variables in this video. A command is simply a slash command, which is executed as the entity the animation controller is applied to. This must begin with a slash, unlike other methods of running commands through add-ons. An entity event follows the syntax @s, followed by an event found on the entity behavior file located in the entities folder of the behavior pack. Explaining entity events requires explaining entities, so for the sake of time, I will explain entities in another video, and I'll link any relevant information in the description. The syntax for Behavior Pack Animation Controller is very straightforward. As with any file in the Behavior Pack, this is a JSON object in a .json file. As with most other files, a format underscore version value is required. As of this video, the accepted format versions are 1.8.0, 1.10.0, and 1.18.10, which fixes a bug with the controllers. Format versions can be complicated, but the recommended practice is to use the latest one available on your current version. That means if you are on version 1.18.10 or above, use the 1.18.10 format version. If, for example, you were on version 1.17.10, you wouldn't be able to use the 1.18.10 format version, and so you'd be advised to use the 1.10.0 format version. Setting the format version to your current version isn't hugely game-breaking, as Minecraft has a safe fallback system to the latest acceptable version. This video assumes the syntax of a 1.18.10 format. The animation controller file starts with a top-level object known as animation underscore controllers. Within the object contains all the animation controllers that are specified. Typically, more than one animation controller is declared per file. Animation controllers are also objects, typically with their key following the syntax of controller.animation. Followed by some form of unique identifier. Within these objects is where the state machine lies. An optional value, but generally recommended, is initial underscore state. This specifies the state that the entity starts in when it is loaded. If this is not included, default becomes the value for initial underscore state. Following this value is an object called states. This contains every state used in the animation controller. The states object contains nested objects with the key of the state name, for example, default. Within each state object contains information about each state. Every item in each state is an array or list, declared by square brackets. Transitions is the key name for an array declaring how this state moves into other states. Within the array are objects, each with a single key and value. The key is identical to the state it is intended to move into. The value is the condition in which to do so. These are typically mulling queries that test for specific information. Mulling is another large topic which I'll be covering in a separate video. I'll link some information in the description. For example, if we wanted to move into the sleep state when the player is sleeping, we would set the key to sleep with a value of query.is_sleeping. For reference, 1 or 1.0 always evaluates to true, while 0 or 0.0 always evaluates to false. Moving past the transitions key, the state has onEntry and on_exit keys. As the name suggests, onEntry runs something when the state is moved into, and onExit runs when the machine transitions into a different state. These both have the same functions as an array which contains strings of different commands, variable declarations and modifications, and entity events. Finally, there's the animations key. This key is complicated. While you can simply declare a value here, it's important to understand where this comes from and how it works before touching this. A behavior packed animation runs commands, entity events, and performs variable functions, but unlike animation controllers, these tasks can be specified to run at different times, using keyframes. A keyframe is simply a point in time with reference data. You may have used this before if you edit a video or animate an object on Blender, Blockbench, or something else similar. You choose a point in time, set some data, then move forward a bit and set some different data, and the software will render the time in between the two points smoothly, producing an animation effect without having to specify data frame by frame. This is exactly the case when it comes to resource pack animations. The animations specify certain keyframes along the timeline and specify data, allowing Minecraft to smooth it out and produce an effect. It's impossible to smooth out the process of running a command, so behavior pack animations run their specified task at the point along the timeline. If you set the animation to run a command 1 second after the animation starts, then that's what it will do. This means you can sequence different times to run commands, allowing you to time commands. Additionally, an animation can loop itself. An animation length value needs to be specified for Minecraft to understand when the animation should loop. By setting the loop key to the value of true, the animation can essentially function as a repeating command block, subtracting any conditional commands. Similar to animation controllers, the syntax for behavior packed animations is clean enough to understand. This is a JSON object and a .json file. The typical format underscore version key is limited to 1.8.0 and 1.10.0 as of this video. Like I mentioned previously, it is recommended to set this to the latest version available. This video assumes the 1.10.0 format version. There is an animations top level object containing all the animations of the file. Nested in this object are additional objects with a key that follow the syntax of animation dot, followed by a unique identifier. Within this is the actual animation data. The loop key specifies whether or not to loop the animation when it has finished playing. This has two values, true and false, which respectively tell the animation to either repeat or stop. Following that, animation underscore length lets the game know the length of the animation. All keyframe times must be below this number. If loop has been specified to true, the amount of seconds between each time the animation will loop will be equal to the animation length value. The timeline object then specifies actions to do at each point in time. Within this object are arrays. The key of each array is equal to the time along the timeline in which to trigger the tasks inside the array. For example, having a key of 3.5 means the task will be triggered 3.5 seconds after the animation has begun. This supports up to 6 decimal places, even though you likely won't need any more than 2. Having such minuscule differences in time is rather pointless. Everything within the array is the same as the things you can do in the on_entry and on_exit arrays of the animation controllers. Simply adding an animation or animation controller file isn't enough to start allowing it to function. The game would be unable to determine the entity the file should be targeted towards. Instead, the animation or controller needs to be connected to the entity. If your entity is vanilla, copy over its vanilla behavior pack file into the entity's folder of your behavior pack. If your entity is custom, be sure to open its file to modify it. Locate the description object. The two objects within this that you need to add are scripts and animations. Within the scripts object, an animate array needs to be created. This specifies animations or animation controllers to instantly run or run with a condition. Define a short name which can be of your choosing. Alternatively, you can add an object to an array and then define a short name of your choosing as the key with a value as the condition in order to run this animation controller or animation. The animations object assigns the short name to an animation or a controller. Each key in the object is a short name that is referenced elsewhere, and the value is the identifier of the animation controller, starting with animation dot or controller.animation dot. Assuming your JSON and syntax is valid, this connects the animation controller or the animation to the entity of your choosing. Going back to the animation controller file, using the short names referenced in the animations object of the entity file, animations can be called in the animations array of this controller. When the state is moved into, the animation will run. Animations can also be run through scripts animate array as declared in the entity file. There are many ways animation controllers and animations can be incorporated into an add-on. I use them in my morph add-on and will use it as an example. 3 animation controllers and 2 animations are connected to the player entity file. The items declared in the scripts animate array are run all the time, which are all the animation controllers. The morph animation controller detects all the different items the player could be holding and activating and transitions into a proper state because of it. Upon entering the proper state, a function is ran which declares all the commands needed to morph the player. The controller then transitions back into the default state to begin testing other conditions. The fire_immune and fly animation controllers are similar in concept. The controllers test to make sure the player is one of the acceptable mobs and then transitions into the activated state and calls the animation short name. This goes into the entity file reference, finds the proper animation, and then activates the animation. The animation then runs certain commands and loops every 10 seconds to make sure the effects are applied, but also removed later. When the controller detects that the player is no longer in one of the acceptable mobs, the animation stops and the controller transitions back into the default state. I understand I did not explain the conditions, however that is related to mulling and is another vast topic, so that will be covered in another video, and I'll link resources in the description. Throughout my experience of witnessing beginning add-on creators, I've found that animation controllers and animations can be hard to grasp. One of my first add-ons was a copy of a death counter add-on, which uses an animation controller. I did not understand most of it and was blindly following a tutorial. However, over time, I figured it out, simplified it in a way that I understood, found many other resources that could have helped me or others, eventually compiling this video. I've done my best since then to explain what I know to people starting out. Minecraft as a game is wonderful in that while it's fun, there are many aspects of it where you can dive deeper and learn professional skills. Redstone teaches you the basics of electronics, and the many videos out there show the simplicity of a computer once it's broken down, among others. Building teaches you the different ways colors work together to help or hurt one another. It teaches you planning, architecture, and if you're on a team, it teaches you lifelong teamwork skills that transfer to the real world. Commands, add-ons, they all teach you something. They teach you how to research, debug, follow the syntax and documentation, find ways to solve problems, and think logically to break down a task into smaller chunks. As of today, and for the foreseeable future, my goal on the CDA 94581 channel is to teach add-ons and bring it to a more accessible light. I want to do my best to explain every part that I know in a simple way that everyone can understand. I want to give you the tools and resources necessary for you to learn on your own and make your own creations. Because no matter how much you might doubt yourself, you all are equally capable. I hope to expand this to other topics like commands, but that is something in the far future. Because of the seemingly complicated nature of animation controllers, I find it only fitting to ask for your input. You are the person watching from an unbiased perspective. You are the person learning this topic. I am not. I already know this stuff. What this means is that I might explain something in a way that makes sense to me, but makes no sense to anyone else. Months ago, I created a video explaining behavior pack animation controllers. That video, even by my standards, explained nothing. My ask of you, if any part of this video is confusing, please leave a comment referencing that part and ask for clarification. If there's any way this video could have been improved, I ask you to explain it. This only helps me help you. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you for being interested enough and doing enough research to find this video. My only hope is that this was beneficial to you. I have linked additional resources that may benefit you in the description. I'm active in the comments to answer any questions, assuming they are comprehensible. Whatever the case, whether or not you are interested in add-ons or not, I thank you for being the amazing person you are, and I wish you all a great day.